Hey, I'm Sadie Sink, and while you might have enjoyed all the horror and mayhem in the Fear Street trilogy, there might be a few things you missed. These are some of the Easter eggs in the series. Spoilers ahead! Seriously, don't watch if you haven't seen any of the films. R.L. Stine's Fear Street novels were essential reading for any kid who grew up in the 90s who loved horror. The films contain nods to R.L. Stine's original stories, too. In the very first scene, Heather opens the first film reading the log line to The Wrong Number, which is the fifth Fear Street book, out loud.
It began as a prank and ended in murder. Fantastic choice.
Although the title of the book and its cover art match that of Stine's 1990 novel, the author's name has been changed to Robert Lawrence, aka R.L. Stine. Heather uses a copy of The First Evil to stop the Skull Mask killer from stabbing her. At least, the first time he tries. In the third film, when the action returns to the Shadyside Mall, Dina tapes multiple copies of the Fear Street books onto her chest as a makeshift armor, a move that saves her life, crafty and smart. R.L. Stine isn't the only master of horror who is honored throughout the Fear Street films. Stephen King also gets a lot of love in the trilogy. You can see King's books on display in the first and third films' 1994 segments. Most noticeably, his novel Insomnia, which would have been a very new release at the time, is prominently featured on a poster and on the front shelves. He also gets several call-outs in the second film, where shared love of King's novels brings my character Ziggy and Nick Good closer together at Camp Nightwing. Stephen King, great for romance.
Huh. Looks like blood.
Yeah, well, I didn't have a pig, so...
Carrie. Cool.
It's not only horror novels that the Fear Street films shout out. There are a lot of clever references to other films from the horror genre.
Go ahead. Carry on.
The 1994 segment, for example, has a lot of respect for Wes Craven's iconic teen slasher film, Scream. The creepy call Heather gets before she's stalked around the store by the Skull Mask killer strikes the same level of tension as that iconic opening scene with Drew Barrymore.
Why do you want to know my name?
I want to know who I'm looking at.
What did you say?
Even the killer's costume bears a striking resemblance to the Ghostface getup that terrorized the teens of Woodsboro, California. 1978 also calls back to some of the best slasher picks of its era. The entire feel of Camp Nightwing is instantly reminiscent of Friday the 13th's Camp Crystal Lake, a getaway that also featured counselors who were too caught up in their own drama to protect themselves or the children from the maniac picking them all off one by one. When will these counselors learn?
Okie dokie.
Tommy. As for the killers in the film, some of them might remind you of the killers from movies past, including Billy Barker, whose childish mask might just remind you of a young Michael Myers, and the deviant milkman Harry Rooker, who wields a knife just like the grown version of the Halloween monster. And when it comes to the axe-wielding maniac of the movie, Tommy, he takes a note out of Jack Torrance's playbook in The Shining when he attacks the mess hall door. That was terrifying. Finally, you'd have to be a serious cinema buff to notice that the third part, which is set in 1666, plays tribute to the themes of Terrence Malick's 2005 film, The New World. Janiak, the director, was particularly inspired by the film's depiction of the beautiful world made rotten. You can really see that influence in Fear Street during the mob's rush to self-righteousness and the destruction as the blight begins to take hold in Union. Outside of actual horror references, the way that Fear Street weaves the three movies together has some interesting plot parallels you might have missed. The mothers of 1994 Samantha and her 1666 double Hannah Miller offer similar words of condemnation for their girlfriends, Dina and Sarah. In both eras, the mothers accuse their daughters' lovers of trying to ruin their children.
You won't stop until you've ruined her life completely, will you?
You won't stop until you've completely ruined her life, will you?
Mother! You shut your mouth!
There's also some clever continuity in the nicknames that the characters give to their mind-altering substances. In the 1994 story, Kate refers to the pills she sells as blueberries. In 1666, the kids try to get actual hallucinatory berries from the mysterious widow. Perhaps the most heartbreaking instance of history repeating itself happens with two different characters from the 1994 timeline. After Heather unmasks the Skull Mask Killer and realizes that it's her close friend Ryan, she begs him to stop, saying, "It's me." Later on, after Sam has been possessed by the devil and attacks Dina, Dina makes a similar plea using the same words. This time, however, it works. Go, Dina. Many times in all three films, the characters foreshadow certain fates by threatening to kill one another. Even when the characters are joking, these deaths often happen anyway. I mean, there are a lot of deaths. After Dina gives Sam her sweater, she teases,
"If you get blood on it, I'll kill you."
As you know, she does end up killing Sam, kind of, in an effort to break the spell. Then there's the camp counselor in 1978 who, during his Color War speech, jokes that it is time to murder those Shadyside witches, just before Nick curses the same folks to meet brutal ends before the night is over. Cindy Berman jokes that she might have to murder her boyfriend Tommy Slater, not knowing that he has secretly become Shadyside's newest psycho killer. Oops. Another moment is when my character Ziggy turns to Nurse Lane for a salve to help with her burn.
"You'll survive."
Which is much more prescient than she realizes. There are also a lot of subtle clues that the good boys are actually very evil. For example, the Sunnyvale mascot is the devil, which is direct reference to the dark origin of the founding family. Certain visual clues pop up in the 1978 storyline as well, like Nick Good literally having blood on his hands and a snake crawling into his lap like a loving pet. And in 1994, perhaps the biggest clue about Sheriff Good's true nature comes in his brief interaction with Martin, when Good says that the cans of spray paint used to vandalize the town are his.
"Somebody planted that. Those ain't my cans."
"You're right, Martin. These are actually my cans."
It seems like a joke at first until you realize that they actually are Good's. That means he's been the one tagging Shadyside with the poem about the witch, ensuring that no one will ever forget the story that kept his family off the public's radar for so many centuries. That's it for some of the Easter eggs in Fear Street. Go back and rewatch all three now streaming on Netflix. Let us know some of the Easter eggs you noticed in the comments below.